Oh, All right, Miss Leslie's going to go get the music box. Isn't it good to be in the Lord's house tonight? And while she's coming, thank you so much for being here. And we're going to have her sing just a little bit, and then we're all pinch hitting for some of the folks that couldn't be here tonight. And real quickly while she's getting that, Miss Vicki asked me to announce that Sunday is... Sunday afternoon is going to be the church picnic and baptism, and that'll be over at the Clay County Rec Park starting at 4, correct? 4 o'clock. So anybody that is needing or wanting to be baptized will need to meet with us before then and let us know and get on that list just so we know ahead of time who's planning on being baptized. So if you have folks that you know of that are needing to do that or wanting to do that before Sunday, please make sure you help us pass that word along and let them know as well. Y'all give Miss Leslie a hand tonight as she sings.
Joy untold, his life for mine. had another one I had on my mind.
Then sings my soul.
Amen. Wasn't that good? Give her another clap offering tonight. Thank you, Miss Leslie, for singing. We appreciate you so much for being here tonight. If you got your Bibles, turn with us to Galatians chapter number 6. Galatians chapter number 6. We're going to pray at the end tonight. I know there's some that have asked to stand in for some others and some that are going to be in need of that tonight. And we certainly want to honor that and get to that here in just a few moments. And if you need prayer, we're going to do that at the end. Much to be in prayer about and prayer for, I know. If you got your Bibles, Galatians chapter 6, let's turn there. Very familiar scripture tonight. We'll stand in reverence to God's word when you can. And Galatians 6, looking in verse number 1. The Bible said, "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if a man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth himself. Let every man prove his own work, and then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone, and not in another. For every man shall bear his own burden." Father, as humble as I know how tonight, God, I'm grateful to you. Lord, for the privilege just to be in your house again. Lord, we're thankful for the good singing that we've heard. God, we're thankful for the sweet Spirit of God, the presence of God. Lord, tonight I'm thankful for the people of God. Lord, thank you for those that have gathered here tonight and thought it a good thing to be amongst your house. Lord, there are many that can't be here tonight for different reasons, God, sickness and things that are going on. And Lord, I pray, God, that you would meet them and help them wherever they are. God, whatever's going on in their life, God, that didn't allow them to be in the house of God tonight, Lord, I pray that you would encourage them, strengthen them, heal them, help them, God. But may they know, Father, that you're a very present help in a time of trouble. Lord, for those that are watching tonight online, Father, I pray whatever their needs are, God, would you be mindful to them and would you help them tonight? Lord, help me to decrease. And God, may you increase. Lord, I pray that I would not say or do one thing, God, that's outside your will or way. Lord, may everything that we say or do give you glory and give you honor and give you praise. And we'll give you the glory for it all in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. A very familiar passage of Scripture to you tonight. And I've had this on my heart for many, many weeks now, just sort of waiting. I know sometimes preachers say things and it sounds strange or sounds like we're just making stuff up sometimes, I think, but had this on my heart for a long time, just waiting on the go-ahead, so to speak, on when to be able to preach it. And I know that may sound odd to you, but believe it or not, you don't always have liberty to just preach whatever you want, whenever you want. And some of you understand what I'm talking about, but several months ago, I don't remember exactly the timeline, but Brother John David taught through the entire book of Galatians in Sunday school class and did a phenomenal job on that particular text, and as he always does, and went through this much more in depth than I can cover in one night, so this will be much less in depth than he did in that lesson. But I want to give you my heart tonight. And so this familiar passage of Scripture begins in Galatians chapter number 6. But what we find is when you take this all in context, and by the way, it's very important, and I'm learning more every day and trying to learn more every day about correct context of Scripture and trying to do that. And we've talked a lot about that in Sunday school class, and it has been keep bringing John David up, but it's been a huge, huge help to me, and I'm thankful for him and thankful for that and that discernment and that teaching. And so when you read this particular text of Scripture, in order to understand it, you actually have to go back into chapter 5 to an even more familiar passage of Scripture dealing with the fruit of the Spirit in order to understand fully all of this text. I say by way of introduction that Christian character is probably one of the most important things that we as people of God ought to focus on, because without true Christian character, then it becomes really, really easy to become what we call hypocritical. In other words, we say we're Christians, but we don't necessarily expound or act out on what the Bible says a Christian ought to do. But Christian character is not mere moral or legal correctness, but it is, one could say, the possession and manifestation of the nine graces that are referred to in Galatians 5, 22 and 23, known as, we often call it, the fruit of the Spirit. And taken together, when you look at these fruits of the Spirit, you find that they present a moral portrait of Christ and then also what the Christian life should manifest and what it should be. And when it's done correctly and strategically, and one is manifesting and producing and possessing the fruit of the Spirit, then it is summarized in what Paul wrote in Galatians 2 and verse number 20 when he uses this phrase in that very familiar verse of Scripture. You can look it up if you want to read the entire verse in Galatians 2:20, but it is summarized in this "not I, but Christ" mentality. In other words, Paul is saying the life that I live in the flesh that I'm living right now, it is not I, but Christ. In other words, it's because of what Christ has done in me that allows me to be able to live this life and to be able to manifest these fruits of the Spirit. It is them being exalted in the life of every believer and gives us this picture of the fruit that Jesus also taught about in John 15, 1 through 8. And this character is possible because the believer becomes in vital union with Christ and is wholly the fruit of the Spirit in those believers who have yielded to Him. In other words, you cannot manifest the fruit of the Spirit unless we have completely committed and submitted our lives to Jesus Christ. How many of you would believe with that? Or how many would agree with that? There's no way that you can manifest these things without the power of God working in you, because the warring of our flesh against the Spirit without Christ's help and being walking in the Spirit, as he says in another verse, the importance of walking in that Spirit allows us then to manifest the fruit of the Spirit. And we find, can I quickly summarize them? I'm not going to bore you, but I'm trying to introduce this before you can move into Galatians 6. You have to understand what is going on here. And those fruits of the Spirit are these: love, joy, peace, and long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. You can further split those up into three different categories, each maintaining three of the fruit of the Spirit. Number one is the character as an inward state. The first three, love, joy, and peace, describe Christian character dealing with the inward state of the Christian. Love being the willing, sacrificial giving of oneself for the benefit of another without thought of return. Joy then being gladness of heart. How many, can I say, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on all these because I know you know them, but I don't want to bore you and I want to get on to Galatians 6. But how many of you know, I believe it's important that people of God be happy and glad and have a smile and look like they're happy to be alive. Somebody say amen right there. I mean, we ought to be happy. I understand we go through things, but as an inward state, this joy does not have anything to do with our current circumstance. It has to do with what is going on the inside of us, not what's going on around us or on the outside. Paul said, "The joy of the Lord is my strength." Now, he's saying these things having been shipwrecked and beaten and going through it. So it has nothing to do with our outward state, but rather understanding whose we are and who we belong to. Then peace becomes a tranquility of mind, freeing one from worry and fear. Those are the inward state characters. Then there's character in how we express ourselves toward man. These are important, and I'll tell you, these things sound really, really good on paper. Anybody ever felt like you could amen the Bible but found out that it's a lot more difficult to actually do it than it is to read it and agree with it? I mean, like, would y'all make me feel better tonight and agree with me that most of the Bible is really easy to agree with, but most of it is not actually as easy to actually do? Y'all making me feel better tonight because sometimes you feel like you're the only one like that. Like everybody else just has an easy old time once you get saved, living it all out. But I'm telling you, it's a lot harder to live it than it is to amen it. I mean, it feels good to amen the preacher on Sunday, but then on Monday when you really got to do it. Here it is. See, character is the inward state. Those three, actually, I'll be honest with you, I feel pretty good about those, Brother Chris. But the character and expression, how we express ourselves towards men, these involve the next three fruit of the Spirit. Long-suffering. This means patience with others, and it is better understood when you understand what the opposite is. It's the opposite of having a short temper, and it becomes a disposition that quietly bears injury. Gentleness is just nothing more than good old-fashioned kindness. And then there is goodness that becomes generosity. What about the last three? Describes our character in how we express ourselves toward God. Faith in this particular context means actually being dependable or dependability. Meekness is gentleness and is courtesy and consideration in one's relations with others. How many of you ever been in a place where you just felt like whatever you wanted mattered? Then there is temperance, which is self-control or the ability to harness and control one's passions or lusts. So then it is the verses of Galatians 5, 22 through 23 that describe the virtue of being a Christian rather than, if you back on up even further, the vices that are afore described in verses 19 through 21 that characterize them that are Christ. It's this fruit of the Spirit that shows the model of what the Christian character should be. And then we arrive to Galatians chapter 6, verse number 1. I'm going somewhere. Hang on. He starts this particular verse and this particular chapter with brethren. And this particular word at the beginning of a sentence does not necessarily indicate the commencement of a new section, thought, topic, or discourse, to which notion we often think that there should be another new chapter. In fact, that's probably why the chapter was divided. But in fact, he's actually about to refer back to the fruit of the Spirit. And so you really wouldn't even have a division in chapter here. Is that making sense? You really could just continue it right on. And in fact, this paragraph most closely connects to the fruit of the Spirit. The apostle's object is to point out that not even a moral delinquency into which a brother has fallen should lead us to indulge ourselves in any feeling of superiority in dealing with him or to vaunt to our own selves. In short, he is enforcing by a strong instance the previous exhortation in verse 26 when he said, "Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another or envying one another. Let us not be desirous of this vain nature." And he exhorts them in chapter 6, verse 1, by saying, "Brethren, if a man is overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest thou also be tempted." In other words, can I quickly summarize this and then we'll do a little bit deeper dive? In other words, be careful not to actually, some of you may find this hard to believe, but there are some people that actually are excited about other people falling. There are some people that actually secretly rejoice when you blow it. I remember my pastor growing up. Pastor Clark was a wonderful man of God. Preached fire down from heaven. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful man. But he said when God saved him, he was a drunk. And he told story time after time. Part of his testimony was that there were literally people that told him,
when he got saved and announced his call to preach, that told him, I'll give you about 6 months and you'll be back. At that time, we were a dry county. Anybody still remember those days? And people used to go to that little joint right there at the red light when you go out of Hayesville and you get right there to the red light at the intersection where you can go either to Hiawassee or Young Harris. There used to be a beer joint right there just across the line, and people would go. And he said there were literally people that would wait on him on a Saturday night and wait there to see if he was going to show back up to the beer. And they would have been excited had he have fallen and went back to the old lifestyle. There are people that when we mess up and fall, they are not excited because you have fallen, but rather because it is utilized to make them feel better about themselves. Y'all still with me, ain't you? This fault, if a man be overtaken in a fault, it's meaning to sin and to miss a mark on the way or to not hit the mark. One who keeps missing the mark in his relationship to God, or to err, to swerve from the truth, or to go wrong. There are burdens that we ought to share. This trespass that is overtaken in this particular text, the Bible said if he be overtaken in a fault, implies that the trespass has overwhelmed the individual. Here's what one writer said: before they could even help themselves. It implies that one has been overtaken by the force of temptation, and the writer admonishes the reader to beware lest thou also be tempted. Where the fault may be a deliberate overstepping of divine boundaries. The trespass may not be some heinous crime that we often allow our minds to immediately assume, but it may be nothing less than one of the works of the flesh that were previously mentioned in Galatians 5, 19 through 21. The preposition in, if a man be overtaken in a fault and not by fault, points to this unhappy condition in which the delinquent would be, and thus the writer admonishes the Christian through charity to assist that person with their extrication from that fault. Y'all still with me, right? Notice who the call goes to. The call goes to those that are spiritual. It becomes incumbent upon those that are spiritual to utilize the position that God gave them, not position as in pastor or deacon, but position as in those that have the fruit of the Spirit, those that are spiritual, those that are capable of recovering them from this fall, not to utilize that as a tool to make themselves look better, but because they are in a place where they can help somebody else. And they are not to be treated as an enemy or an outcast because they have been overtaken in a fault. Can I just stop and say one more time, because I feel like some of y'all are looking at me like I've lost my mind. This is a lot harder to do than it is to agree with. I know I've already said that, but I'm going to say it again. This is a lot easier to agree with it than it is to do it. But because this starts incorporating, when you incorporate what this really means to be capable to do this, to be capable even to do verse 1, means that it's those that are spiritual that he's speaking to, which means you have to be capable of possessing and manifesting the fruit of the Spirit, which means you got to be walking in the Spirit. Which means you got to be really close to Christ to even be able to accomplish this. But it's the will of God to fulfill the law of Christ, he says in the next verse, that we be able to do this. But can I tell you what else this encompasses? When we talk about people that are overtaken in a fault and we are spiritual and to restore them, it encompasses all of the Bible. It encompasses that we have to be able to set our own pride aside to be able to lend a hand to somebody else that many would pass by. What do you mean by it encompasses the whole Bible? This particular text, you could utilize the story of the Good Samaritan as demonstration of how this actually happens. Would you agree with that? I mean, it takes somebody that is willing to go out of their way, who has never, Brother LB, I never even really thought about it like this, but the Good Samaritan, his name, other than we call him the Good Samaritan, is never mentioned. We know about the priest and the Pharisee. We know all those people, but we don't even know who the Good Samaritan was. We just know it was somebody that was strong enough to go out of their way to lift somebody else up that had been overtaken and that was broken and battered and beaten, and pull them up out of that spot and restore them and take them back to the house on their own donkey, on his own beast. He carried him back and restored him. That takes work. It takes effort. It takes having the fruit of the Spirit. You cannot do it unless you have love and joy and peace and faith and temperance and meekness and all these things, gentleness and goodness. It requires them all to be able to do this. Would you agree with that? One writer said the pride of assumed superiority will be the worst possible hindrance in such a work. It is well to remember that if we had met the same temptation, listen to me, if you don't hear anything else, and I can be done in a minute, but it is well to remember that if we had met the same temptation, we might have had even more of a grievous fall. And furthermore, someday our time might come when the present offender may be the one who becomes our restorer. Let the work be done then as by brother to a brother. I'm going to tell you something. When I was studying this, if there was a statement that brought me to my face and that brings humility, it is the fact that when we understand that the one we help today is just as much loved by God as those who are the ones that are in a place where they can help. And may the Bible says, let a man take heed when he stand, lest he fall. We very well could be the one that needs somebody to reach out to us tomorrow. Hello? I mean, we could very well be the one that we need somebody to show us grace tomorrow. He goes on to say a Christian must have strong shoulders and stout legs in order to bear the flesh. That is, the flesh that includes the weakness of another brother. I don't know if this is helping y'all as much as it did me, but Christian life is about burden bearing, but after all, it is something short of the supreme sacrifice which Christ himself spoke about when he said we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Oh, listen, can I tell you something? There's been times it's been too much for me because of my pride to bear somebody else's burden. But Christ taught, by the way, Jesus' teachings are a lot more difficult than we actually let on sometimes. Somebody say amen right there. You know why? Because sometimes I act like bearing somebody's burdens too much, but Jesus said, oh, we ought to lay down our life for the brethren. Jesus is the one that taught. I know it's a whole different topic, but Jesus said, oh, listen, you've heard it been said that thou shalt not kill, but I'm telling you, if you murdered your brother in your mind, Jesus was a lot more to the point. Facts are, we couldn't really handle Jesus is preaching. But we have it in the Word of God, and we are still to follow the Word of God. Amen? Christian life is about burden bearing. Then he goes on to tell us, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, restore him in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. It means to bring back to the proper condition. Used in, you've heard this before, I'm sure, but in Matthew 4:21, it's the context of mending a net, or one writer described it as repairing a broken limb. That restoration implying the gentle nature that must be utilized in dealing with these. conditions. Now, do you know why that we would restore? To allow that person. We would call it in the South, we would call it, they just need a little help getting back on their feet. Does anybody know? Here's a 20 till you can get back on your feet. I mean, anybody know what I'm talking about? $20 won't help you much now. You better make it 100 this day. Here's 100 to help you till you get back on your feet. Here's a hand. I'll come cut your grass till you can get back on your feet. But in this particular context, you know what he's talking about? He's talking about we restore them so that they can get back to the duty and responsibility that they have in their own relationship with Christ. And I'll tell you something, we need more soldiers for Christ. We do not need more people who are falling out and leaving. I'm going to try hard not to get ahead of myself, but hurry all at the same time, which is really difficult to do. One person described it as, listen, y'all can make fun of me if you want to for having a bag. It's fine. You can call it a man purse. You can call it a man bag. You can call it whatever you want. Listen, it doesn't bother me. I don't care. It keeps my Bible from getting destroyed in the back of my truck with three hoodlums as they climb in there 400 miles an hour. Somebody say amen right there. It's at least tucked away in here. Here's the thing. Again, I'm not trying to get too far ahead of myself, but I don't want to bore you with just reading all my notes. Can I try to demonstrate this for you real quick? The writer goes on, and I know I'm going to miss some things here without going, but we all must also bear our own burden. I'll get to that in a little bit, but here's the thing. How many of you know we need soldiers in the army of God? We need people that can be about the Father's business. Would you agree with that? We do not need to lose more people. And we do not need to beat people when they're broken and down. Some of y'all are like, I don't know what you're talking about. Y'all are looking at me like I've lost my mind. We need a whole lot more restoration that puts people back on their feet. And like it or not, and back in the seat because they have been restored and loved and then nurtured enough that they can then get back to walking in the Spirit and growing in Christ rather than pushing them away because of a current hurt, brokenness, trial, failure. Somebody say amen. The church is the hospital for the broken. But it's not just here. You and I have got to go to the place where we can pick people back up so that then they can carry their load. Every soldier is responsible for carrying his weight. If you line up a whole bunch of soldiers and they're going on a march, listen, Brother Paul, there can't be 20 of them that are not doing anything and somebody else. Every soldier is responsible for his load, for his bag, for his pack. He is responsible to carry his burden. He is responsible to carry. And listen, not only in burden, but we're responsible for doing what God has called us to do as well. But if he falls and is broken, if he is steps out of the way. You know what soldiers do? They have this motto that nobody will be left behind. We will bring everybody with us one way or the other. And if that means that temporarily I've got to get down here with them in the dirt, in the ditch, and still carry my load, but help them carry their load too, one way or the other, we're going to restore him and get him back on track. That's what the church has to do with people that are broken. It means to mend a net, set a broken limb. You know what I'm guilty of sometimes? I used this analogy the other night with somebody. You know what I'm guilty of sometimes? I'm trying to work on this, Brother John David, with my kids. I really am. How many know it's frustrating when you've told them something and they don't listen, and then exactly what you told them, they go do it. And exactly what you told them was going to happen if they did not do what you told them to do. You know what I'm trying to get better at? Brother Scotty, I'm trying to get better at not lecturing them while they're bleeding. It's... But it's such a good opportunity. They can't run away in that moment. Like, you don't. Listen, you be quiet and hear me out, or you're going to bleed to death. But when I get done telling you what you did wrong, then I'll fix your. See, y'all laugh, but that's what we do sometimes to people. The reason you're in the ditch with your head gashed open is because you didn't wear a helmet, you idiot. And you know that you're supposed to wear a helmet. What a great time to tell them about it, right? You know what God showed me, though, Brother Paul? Even if I use my best preacher voice, even if I stomp and snort and clap my hands, and even if I quote Bible verses right then and there, it doesn't stop the bleeding. Telling them he should have had a helmet on does not stop his bleeding, LB. It just don't. It doesn't take the sting away. But you know what does? Are you okay? Now, I'm not talking about we overlook things. There may be a place where we get and we reiterate, the helmet would have helped. Right? But how many of you know sometimes we get it all out of order? We want to tell everybody the reason you blew it. Let me tell you what else I've heard. And this right here really isn't going to help them. This does not help church attendance. I knew it was going to happen. Now, that'll bless you right there. That'll bless you while you're laying in the ditch when somebody looks at you and says, I knew that's where you was going. Then why didn't you help me? I hope y'all are getting this tonight. When people are bleeding, grievous and sensitive wounds, whether by sin or otherwise, you cannot find where there's any other way to handle them other than delicately in a spirit of meekness, which literally means gentleness. And that involves courtesy and consideration in dealing with somebody else. Notice what the writer said, consider in yourself, lest you also be tempted. Some burdens are to be shared. Some burdens are to be shouldered. I'm going quick. How many of you know there's some things I can't carry for you, though? I can't carry your sin. I can't carry your position with God when it comes time to die. There are some things, there are some burdens, there are some places that you must carry yourself. I can't make somebody get saved. I can't get saved for them as bad as I'd like to. Every man will have his own burden. Every man must prove his own work and then have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. See, instead of comparing one's virtues with the moral blemishes of another, one is to compare himself with his own achievements against the backdrop of his responsibility that's given to him or her by God. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 12, he is writing and using this illustration in regards to examining himself and testing his own conduct. And here's what he said. He said, "Our rejoicing is this, the testimony of our conscience, that in simplicity and godly sincerity, not with fleshly wisdom, but by the grace of God, we have had our conversation in the world and more abundantly to you word." This Greek word for burden in verse 2 is baros, meaning moral weakness or a burden that is too heavy for a person to bear alone. As we previously discussed, but the word in verse 5 is fortion, meaning a personal responsibility that can and should be borne by that individual. We are individually responsible to God. You know what that means? It means that I am not excusing sin because I pull somebody out of the ditch. Right? You're still accountable yourself to God. It does not excuse it because you lift them up and help and love and restore. But I'll tell you this much. They're not going to come to the knowledge and the saving grace of God any other means than if the people of God don't reach out to them. People that are already children of God that blow it and mess up, they're most likely not going to come back to church unless the people of God love them and lift them up and restore them. That's why when you understand this, it is so much more peaceful when you read Matthew 11:30 and find out when Jesus said, "My yoke is easy and my burden is light." Aren't you glad that Christ does not put more on us? In fact, He longs to take it away. But I've been guilty sometimes of being like the Pharisees in Matthew 23:4, where sometimes we bind heavy burdens that are grievous to be borne and we lay them on men's shoulders. You ever been there? You ever made something more heavy for people instead of helping them? Last thing, I'm done. Some burdens are to be shed. I probably used this analogy before, but I'm going to use it again. Some burdens you got to cast off. Some things you're carrying around that you were never meant to carry. Some stuff you're trying to deal with, and it's too heavy for you. Anybody ever been there? It's too heavy for you. Psalm 55:22 said, "Cast your burden upon the Lord and He shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved." Sustain means to strengthen or support physically or mentally. To bear the weight of an object without breaking or falling. Can I tell you something? There is nothing that you'll lay at the feet of Christ. There is nothing you will lay on Him. There is nothing that you will cast off of you and onto Him that will break Him or cause Him to stumble. Sustain means that they can bear the weight of that object without breaking or falling and give support or relief to nourish, to support the weight of, to carry or withstand, to provide hope, to be a source of strength. Does this sound like Christ to y'all or not? To be a high tower and to see, sustain means to see someone through. You know what I found out about Christ? They wrote a song about it a long time ago. It's an old, old, old song. We probably hadn't heard it sung very much in a long time. But it simply says this, Brother Paul, you probably remember it. He won't just get you by, but He'll see you through. The next line was, Give Jesus a try and see what he'll do. See, some burdens are to be shared. Some burdens are to be shouldered. You got to do those things, but some burdens are to be shed. We used to sing, take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Did I mention at the beginning that's easier to amen than it is to do? Did I mention that? It's easy to take your burden to the Lord. How many of you would agree with that? I mean, that part, we got it down. You know what's not easy to do? When you turn to go home, it's not easy to not pick it back up again. I don't exactly know why that is. Sally, come on and play, but I do know this. Sometimes it's because we want it right now. We want an answer right now. Sometimes it's just because we're so accustomed to try to fix things ourselves. And what I found, Brother LB, that got me a long way. Anybody else ever been there? Fixing your own stuff. I mean, like, you've handled it. You've solved problems. You got yourself through. Everything you faced for a long time, you could figure out a way and a solution to it. And you, I mean, it worked for a long time where you could just do it yourself. Anybody know what I'm talking about? But every single one of us, at some point in our life, we will run smack dab face to face with something that we cannot do by ourselves. And when that happens, it is so difficult to give it to the Lord. You remember when I started, I said, all this encompasses the entire Bible. Because when you really give your burden to the Lord, you know what that means? That means sometimes he asks you to actually believe and have faith and trust other parts of the Bible, like be still and know that I'm God. Like, it all starts to add up. Like, you cast your burden on him. You come unto me, all that labor and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. You cast all your care upon him. But then you have to also trust that he cares for you. Then you also have to activate and act on being still and knowing that he's God. It requires doing things like saying, Lord, I'm going to give this burden to you, and I'm going to trust no matter what that if it happens today, if it's not until tomorrow, if it's not next week, if it's not until next month, God, I'm going to trust you that some way, somehow, you're going to take care of my need. And you're going to take care of this burden. But sometimes, I believe with all my heart, I don't know who I'm preaching to, but I believe with all my heart, sometimes God is just waiting for us to say, God, I trust you with everything. And if this does not work out the way I think it should or the way that I want it to, sometimes I believe with all my heart, he's waiting, Brother LB, on us just to say this. I still love you. And I'll still trust you. And I'll still follow you. And I still want to serve you. I still want to live for you. If it doesn't work out the way I think it should, I'm still going to praise you. I'm going to praise you anyway because you're good. I want to follow you anyway because you're good. Tonight, I don't know what you're dealing with, but I know this much. There's a God in heaven that loves you. There's a God who is here right now waiting for you to cast all your care on him. There may be somebody somewhere you need to go to and help lift them up. Somebody may be watching right now at home, and we may need to tell you we love you and we care about you, God still loves you and cares about you. You're not too far gone. You're not too messed up. And even in your brokenness, oh, we'd love an opportunity to restore. We'd love an opportunity to walk beside you. We'd love an opportunity to make it right. There may be somebody you need to go tell that you still love them. You still care about them. As we stand to our feet tonight, Father, I love you. God, I give you glory. Lord, I know as I've studied this for several weeks, Lord, as I've looked at it, Father, it's helped me. I feel like tonight, God, I've struggled to try to say it the way you gave it to me. But Lord, I pray for whatever need and whatever burdens, whatever valleys, God, whatever trials people are dealing with tonight, Father, I pray we'd be obedient. I pray, God, we'd surrender to you. I pray, God, we'd cast our care upon you. Lord, for those that are walking in the Spirit, those, God, that are in tune with you, God, I pray that every opportunity we get to restore and to help somebody, God, we would be the church, we would be the group of people, God, in our community, in our job, in our place, God, that we would reach out and gently, with meekness and kindness, God, that we would nurture them back. Father, that they would long to serve you again. God, if there are people that need to pray right now, Father, I love you. I pray, God, you'd meet needs and do what only you can do. In Jesus' name, for those that asked to come, be prayed over, those that needed to stand in. I know there's many requests tonight. I want you to come right now if you need prayer. If you need prayer, there's those that are praying. If you'll come, come get in this altar if you need to come pray. I'm going to ask you to mind God. Spend a little time with, listen, if there's ever been a time you don't need to rush, spending some time with the Lord, just spend a little time with Him. Just call on Him. Brother Rick, if you want to come right now, I know you're going to be standing in for, for the family, if you'll come on. While they're praying right now, listen. Some of you ought to just come and get around these in this altar. We're going to pray right now. The rest that are available, our elders and our ordained, we're going to come right now and pray and ask God to touch some of these needs and sicknesses. God, we love you. Can you pass that around for me? Miss Betty Tetherow and Charles Bickley. Brickley, we're standing in for him and any others tonight. Brother Cliff's going to stand in for Brother Paul Porter. We believe God's able. Go ahead. Make me blind that I might see.
Amen. Isn't God good tonight? Amen. Give the Lord praise. He's so good to us. I love you. I appreciate you being here tonight. Continue to pray for Pastor Chris and her family on vacation. They'll get rest and safe travels. I know they're enjoying that, and be back Sunday. Also, again, remember the baptism and picnic on Sunday at 4 o'clock. We'll be having hamburgers and hot dogs. It'll be a great time of fellowship. Please make sure that you make plans to be here and be a part of that. And other announcements, I am not sure. Miss Vicki, is there anything else? Anybody else got anything? All right. Thank you for being here tonight. We'll see you Sunday morning. Let's get our hands up and exercise. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.